In the annals of struggle history, there is no country in the world where sport has played such a leading role in a liberation struggle as the role played by non-racial sport in South Africa. Yet the South African story does not acknowledge this fact. The South African story ignores these heroes and ignores the fact that the negotiated settlement of 1994 was nothing more than a callous betrayal of the principles of non-racialism and non-racial sport in South Africa.
Well, I think it would be a real disgrace if the struggle of the non-racial sports movement in South Africa, which was underpinning the struggle in New Zealand and around the world, if that's not recognised by the people of South Africa. There is a whole history there which is so important to the liberation struggle.
The defeat of apartheid gets written through individual heroic acts of one liberation movement.
With all this distortion in history, Mandela and the ANC being called the liberators, although today people are so hurt, this corruption, this dishonesty and all this greed, but they don't want to draw the correct conclusion. It is as if something has gone wrong and they can't understand it.
When we begin to rebuild a truly representative South African sporting structure, we begin on the basis of truth rather than the basis of lies and deception.
As soon as you hear the sound of the Springbok song, then you can all pick up those pieces of cardboard. Remember, the writing must be facing towards you. You need to show either a red side or a white side. All pick up those pieces of cardboard. Remember, the writing must be facing towards you.
Ole, 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 ole.
Make peace with it, man.
Anymore.
Make peace with apartheid, man. Stop fucking struggling with the fucking ball. Let's get on with it. Support us, we're all South Africans. Stand with us.
Sport has been used to create an illusion of democracy, freedom, unity, and equality in South Africa. Yet the reality shows that the oppressed people of South Africa have been betrayed, and their sacrifices have been for naught.
The flag, the symbols, the celebrations. Our people, as they realize that these things have no meaning to them, these things have no relevancy to them, our people will continue turning away, going back to the struggle. And they'll refuse to go back to the caves, as they're being told by the ruling party.
If you talk about unity, it should be, I am fine by virtue of knowing you are fine, you know? But if we are speaking of unity in which a certain sect of society sleeps tight, they fall, but the majority of South Africans aren't, what kind of unity is that, you know? It's throwing dust in the face of the poor. Because here you are portraying a nation that is so united in joy, that is so united across all else, but in reality what you have is a nation with an ever-growing gap between rich and poor, and that gap is growing so fast that we will reach a point we won't be able to close it anymore. You know, we are fast approaching that. Yeah, and sports just makes a mockery of that.
In August 1990, there was a very strong and arrogant sense from F.W. de Klerk's camp that if you just killed enough black people and caused enough divisions, such as IFP versus ANC with the third force, and then gradually the ANC gets worn down and co-opted and corrupted, then the deal would be done. And you could argue that's what they did.
It was a dual strategy and a very clever one by de Klerk. You negotiate with the party and you kill off the grassroots power at the same time so that you don't have a radical push coming from below. You can cut deals with the political party, much better when that political party and that liberation movement doesn't have a radical wing pushing it from below.
They were co-opted into this system. They didn't destroy that oppressive society. That is the trouble.
There's been no social revolution as we understand it in theoretical terms and practical terms. One class hasn't been displaced by another class, the rule of one class by another class. And on the contrary, the continuities between apartheid capitalism and post-apartheid capitalism are there for everybody to see.
Sackhouse holds the seat in the Supreme Council of Sport as the member for this country. And by that act, we hold the future of sport in this country in our hands. Our sportspersons hold the future. An apartheid multinational sport will go nowhere except through the membership of Supreme Council of Sport and through SACOS.
But all of the youth groups, all of the women's groups, all of the civic organizations, all of the other things that came together into the United Democratic Front, the Mass Democratic Movement, whatever, all sorts of other organizations, these constituted a very powerful and very, very energetic and quite a influential group of organizations. And I would argue, and have argued at length, that it was these organizations that were fundamentally responsible for the liberation of this country, not a political party.
The dynamic unity that we forged was effectively crippled with the negotiated settlement in 1994.
Sports boycotts, protests in the townships, trade union mobilization, churches, women, the youth, very tough.
With clubs, knives and petrol, mobs have set on foreigners across South Africa's townships, leaving at least 22 people dead in a week of xenophobic attacks. Women were raped, shops and homes looted, and immigrants were beaten or set ablaze. Hundreds have been trying to seek refuge inside police stations and churches as the South African government appeals for an end to the violence.
How do we organize? Do we organize? And what form and nature and language can we use to galvanize the support of all Africans? Because we said this is an African World Cup for African benefit, but we killed 200,000. We chased them all out of our country in the latest xenophobic attacks. The African Renaissance is a myth.
I just spent the last 4 months in Mpumalanga researching and gathering information about the saga around the Imbombela 2010 World Cup Stadium. Now, if you want a case study in abuse of power, political assassinations, poisoning of individuals, death threats, tender fraud, you name it, it's there. It's there in Mpumalanga, in Mbombela, around that stadium, involving very powerful people from national and provincial and other kinds of levels. Now, that has taken place, but what has resulted as a result of that, poor communities, the Matsafeni community, who, by the way, the local municipality attempted to gyp out of their land for one rand. 60 hectares for one rand they wanted to pay.
We spent so many billions, maybe estimates are 60 billion to get a World Cup, when Dennis Brutus was saying, no, before we have at least a decent social democracy, don't be spending on these luxury games like a World Cup. I mean, everybody was delighted for a while, but now we've got 10 mainly empty stadiums and a huge hangover from that party.
Because with the World Cup gone, I mean, it's gone, it's bubble last time. We have benefited absolutely nothing. I am the chairperson of the local football association. I'm also the member of SAFA Qaqadu. I can tell you there have been no change, absolutely no change at all. We continue to play in playgrounds that is full of stones. I mean, we do not have stadiums. We have absolutely nothing. The World Cup has come, the World Cup is gone. So I think we should able to go back to our own space, because that's not our space, people's space, as I was saying.
There was never even, you know, just the most minor of gestures, assist the soccer team, assist developing soccer here in Rooigrond, you know. That would have been something sustainable. That would have been something worth celebrating, in my opinion. And yes, you know, as a nation, we did well. We portrayed ourselves well in the world and such, but that makes us a very hypocritical nation, because here we are showing off the success when behind the scenes, we just have this sad cycle of events that's happening.
They built a stadium. Somebody asked me a stupid question making a document. They built, King's Park is there. They built a stadium right opposite, Mr. Kali, King's Park. Somebody asked me now, why they're building a stadium? It's stupid. I said, how can it be stupid? Because if we use the same stadium, who's going to get the BE contracts, you stupid?
There is hardship in our townships. We have no water. We have no lights. There are so many things we do not have. But Lord, we have sport. You know, we've got sporting heroes. So that's been fed to them as a nation-building force in their lives. So people forget that the very people who are telling them to fly their flags on a Friday and to blow their whatevers, you know, these are the people who are living off the fat of the land and are helping themselves in the service of a great economic force which the people do not have control of until they begin to take charge of their lives.
The country is in a mess. Our society is in a mess. It's riddled with violence. Huge social and economic inequality, vicious corruption, gangsterism, drug trafficking, the pandemic of AIDS, ill health.
We have a madness of a system where the life expectancy rate of the country is 52, but the first time you can get a pension is when you're 60.
The property clause, for those of you who look at our constitution, the property clause in the constitution sanctifies private property. Now you say, well, what's wrong with that? The problem with that, of course, is that in 1993, 94, when you sanctified private property, you froze apartheid property relations. They became frozen immediately.
I don't know, though, if what appears at the surface to have been a good political strategy didn't undermine things, because it really let the comfort levels of white South Africans stay in place. And I think there, when you try and say, well, we've got one nation and we've got the unity of the nation behind our sports teams, you just have to look at the racial divisions in sports and in sports attendances, you know, and you see the regular repeated incidents of racism within sporting teams and racism expressed by major sporting figures. So it really is not a healed society, and instead of taking this wound and really cauterizing it and looking at how to heal it, we just put a little simple band-aid over it and had some symbols. It just isn't going to work.
The day before the semi-final against France, Mandela appeared at a political rally before his own supporters. But some were puzzled when he put on a Springbok cap. They still associated the green emblem with the old enemy.
You see this cap? This cap does honor to our boys who are playing France tomorrow.
Here is the man wanting us to reconcile. with these brutish people who have humiliated us for ages in our own country.
I ask you all.
I don't think for a moment he thought that was going to be easy.
I ask you all to stand behind them tomorrow, because they are our pride. They are your pride.
Well, our first democratically elected president, you know, became emotional when PNC people in parliament, who happened to be only five, were opposed, you know, to the retention of Springbok as an emblem. He summoned one MP, Kalipile Sizani, who was accompanied to see President Mandela by Benny Barnes. Here, they say to me they were dressed down. And thereafter, the president said, you did not respond. You can see yourselves out. You see, now, as Africans, we'll always have this aspect of respecting President Mandela as a father. And as such, you know, with the way you have to respond, you will respond in a restrained way. Right? So the point I'm trying to make is that it was very unfortunate, believe you me, that thing of a Springbok, you know, to be retained as an emblem. Because the white supremacy mentality in people like John Smith and such people can't go away when they see there's nothing which has changed.
Internally, probably one of the apartheid government's most hated movements of the struggle era, SACUS remained a target for the nationalist government and was regarded as a dangerous rebel organization by the Minister of Sport and Recreation in 1979 South Africa, F.W. de Klerk. In 1987, with the release of selected political prisoners, the groundwork was being laid for the biggest sellout of the struggle in the country's history. And non-racialism and non-racial sport was to be sacrificed in the negotiated settlement leading to the elections in 1994.
I mean, I was never deep into the sport organization as such, but all I know about it and all the people I associated with and supported and so on, I always understood that the real purpose was nation building, in the proper sense of the term. You know, from below, unity because of people playing with one another, people interacting on levels of equality as equal beings and so on. And there was no commoditization, there was no attempt to commodify sport, you know. And I think that, for me, and also the crude way in which this hard work was exploited, was hijacked, for me is really tantamount to betrayal.